old boy. It's a great joke played on us by the Lord or fate or nature, whatever you prefer. But whoever or whatever played it certainly had a sense of humor. The gold has gone back to where we found it. Oh! This is worth 10 months of suffering and labor, this joke is.
Craig Beam, and you are listening to That Twilighty Show About That Zone. Tonight we are talking about two second season episodes, 100 Yards Over the Rim with Cliff Robertson and John Astin, and The Rip Van Winkle Caper starring Simon Oakland and Oscar Barraghy.
Privileged to have Craig on the show. He lends an air of legitimacy to the proceedings. I urge you to go to his sites, My Life in the Shadow of the Twilight Zone at mylifeintheshadowofthetwilightzone.blogspot.com, and also My Life in the Glow of the Outer Limits at mylifeintheglowoftheouterlimits.blogspot.com.
Are they really that long? That sounds like a really long address.
You have to throw in the HTTP also.
Yes.
So it's even longer.
Right.
Before we started recording, Craig and I were talking about how to pronounce Oscar Barraghy's last name, and we couldn't really figure it out. So we had to go and look at the preview to the episode Death's Head Revisited, where Rod Serling actually says his name. So there we had it, right out of Serling's mouth.
So nobody gets to jump in with any kind of challenges.
It's not pronounced that way.
So these
are two indispensable websites filled with voluminous references and facts about these remarkable television shows. Also, there's a lot of fanboy stuff. When I started my podcast, I referred to his sites for information and notes, and also some pictures. Like, there's a lot of it's really fun, and also he offers a take on episodes that most people don't really hear. Some of the episodes that are considered enormous classics, you're not a particular fan of.
Well, I kind of savagely decimated Time of Life at Last.
Right.
In fact, and on your episode, when you looked at that one, I recall you referring to my blog.
Yes. I actually did that because it was a perspective. It was a fresh, it's actually fresh. It's very fresh perspective on something that's a classic. I mean, and some of the episodes that we do on the show, some of my guests don't really like, and others I don't really like. So it's, it's, you know, there are some.
Right. Sure.
I think I'm reminded of Andrew, my friend Andrew, when we talked about the episode, The Monsters Are Doing Maple Street. And he was not impressed. He thought it was really preachy, and he even made fun of it, and he wrote up a little thing about it, about Claude Akins is not having a good day, you know, things like that, which I thought was just... Craig...
Preachy, yeah.
...has also started his own podcast, Between Light and Shadow, in direct competition with mine. And I told Craig when he announced his podcast, it's on! Actually, no, he's the one who said it's on. So...
That sounds like something I would say.
Yeah. So, but from what I understand, from what you've told me, you're going about this in a different way. You're deconstructing the episodes of The Twilight Zone thematically, right?
Probably not as academic as you made that sound. But, you know, generally most podcasts go chronologically, or they just sort of randomize. For me, I'm focusing on the first season, but then I'm also covering similar episodes from later that kind of share a lot of the same thematic stuff.
But that this idea is just wonderful, and based on what I've heard of the promo, it just sounds like it's going to be wonderful coming out. All right, let's move into our episodes. I've taken a cue from you and decided to break them down in a kind of thematic way. These are time shifting episodes of a sort.
They are.
In 100 yards over the rim, we have Cliff Robertson and a group of pioneers. I want to say running wagons from Ohio to California, but his child, this young boy, is sick. He's practically dying. Mm-hmm. Cliff sets off by himself to search for food and water, hopefully medicine. But this was 80 years before the discovery of penicillin, so this kid would have been dead for all intents and purposes.
We've been doing a lot of talking and a lot of thinking.
And?
We figure we ought to turn back.
Turn back? Is that what you figure? Is that what you want?
Chris, we're about at the end of our rope. We're hungry and we're sick. We figure if we don't do it now, we're gonna die out here.
If you try to go the 1,500 miles back to St. Louis, I'll guarantee you'll leave your bones bleached on some desert, or lose your scalps, or freeze in a mountain pass.
What about water, Chris? We're almost out of water.
I'll find us water. I'll get water.
How, Chris? With a divining rod?
I don't know, but I'll find water.
And food, Chris? And medicine for your own child?
I'll take a look at that rim over there.
Chris, you might look for some shady spot. A pretty spot where we might...
We'll not talk about burying our son now, not while there's breath in him. Stay close to the wagons. Keep them bunched up.
Chris... How far are you going?
Just over that rim there, about 100 yards.
He crosses over a sandy hill, and he goes back to the future.
When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious shit.
Some 114 years into the future, the modern world with cars and jets, just lots of noise. Like when that horrible cattle rustler wound up in the future because of the professor's time machine and execution. Except Cliff isn't an idiot. He's scared, the way Albert Salmi was, but he's a good person. He stops at this gas station diner run by John Crawford, who some of you may remember as Commissioner Ferris from the Galileo 7 episode of the original Star Trek television show. He was a jerk in that episode, but he's a nice guy here.
Yes, he's a nice guy.
So Cliff gets freaked out at the sight of a truck coming, accidentally shoots himself with his own gun. He gets to the diner. John Crawford and his wife or girlfriend, I forget, tend to him. They call in a doctor played by Edward Platt, who most of us will remember as the chief from Get Smart. So he treats Cliff's wounds. At first, they think he's crazy, demented, and then they come to the realization this guy ain't from around here. He's decked out all funny. These days, we would assume he was on his way to a steampunk convention.
He's cosplaying.
Yeah, especially in Oregon. They're very big on steampunk there.
This is true.
I have a couple of problems with this episode. I like this episode quite a bit, but I do have a couple of problems here. Maybe you can help me out with them.
I have problems as well. We'll see if they're the same.
Okay. Well, the first one is the time travel elements. I had an issue with his gun. He takes it forward in time. It works. It shoots him in the arm. But at the end of the episode, John Crawford picks up the gun and it crumbles in his hands. Why didn't it crumble when it first shot forward into the future?
It's a great question, and I don't have an answer.
It's like the gun is made of chocolate or something.
Unless there's some kind of like temporal bubble that Horn exists in, as long as he's in the future. I don't know.
That works because you consider the gun is made of the raw elements or whatever, mm-hmm. it's carbon-based, sure. whatever it is, it's going to crumble over time, which means that Cliff would have crumbled into dust had he moved
had
forward.
He stayed. Yeah.
So it makes sense if he's holding a gun, he's sort of like in his own little time bubble, but when that gun or something, even that doesn't really work. That kind of falls apart too.
Yeah. Yeah. Just like the rifle.
And the second issue is that he sees some information about his son, that he'll grow up, he'll become a doctor, a very famous doctor. Mm-hmm. And if Cliff is 114 years in the future, he hasn't done anything yet to save his son, so his son shouldn't exist, and there would be no information. Conversely, if he kills a mosquito 114 years ago, Hitler never dies, Germany captures the world, and the Mets finally win a World Series.
So, sound of thunder.
So unless it's predestined that young Christian should survive, in which case, why bother swiping the penicillin?
Right. And, you know, it's funny about that penicillin. I wasn't there in 61, but penicillin must have been crazy powerful because his kid gets one dose. Now, this kid has been at death's door for however long, a week, 2 weeks. He gets one dose. At the end, he's sitting upright. He's bright-eyed. He's alert. And I'm just thinking, wow, like, where can I score some of that?
Yeah. Very strong penicillin, number one. Number two, you know what? Kids were just tougher back then, you know?
They had to be. We agree on the rifle situation. My other issue with the rifle is he shoots himself in the arm.
Right.
Now, this is an individual who he should be weak from the rigors of cross-country travel. He's malnourished. He's dehydrated. He shoots himself in the arm, and then he gets up and just keeps walking. He's continues to use that arm. He's still holding that rifle. And I'm just thinking, I mean, sure, these guys were stronger than us in general.
Yeah.
I mean, and probably even in his advanced weak state, he could kick my ass.
Probably,
but,
yeah.
But I just, you know, maybe a little more of the injured guy routine, maybe.
You mean like kind of like, oh, my arm, it hurts because I shot it. See,
damn,
I shot
it. Damn, look, it's bleeding. The semi truck is barreling down the highway.
Yeah.
And he jumps out of the way, shoots himself in the arm, and he gets a pretty good look at it. Right. But when he refers to it, when he's talking to the diner owner, he, you know, he's like, you know, did you see that monster?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, well, it's clearly not an organic being. You know, this is not some large desert dwelling creature.
Yeah.
And it's rolling along on four wheels, you know, like his wagon. It might look a bit strange, but wouldn't he maybe think maybe this is some kind of a vehicle? You know, at the very least.
He could see the wheels, that it's obviously like a mechanized variation on his wagon.
Or a train.
Or a train, yeah.
Now, those were common in 1847.
But he said, he was like, there's a big monster out there. You know, somebody comes into my diner and asks me, did you see that monster? I would wet myself because I would assume there was a real monster out there. Oh, my God, what is it? Is it a lion? Is it a bear?
I mean, they're traveling west for a better life. And I just feel like, is it that hard to believe that maybe the Westerners developed like a trackless railway system?
Yes.
You take a look at him, Doc?
I did indeed. Malnutrition, that's his major problem. Although he's not a bad specimen of a man, I'll say that. Huh? And you were right, Joe. He's an interesting customer.
Must have been the heat, huh? Or something. Well, I mean, Doc, he's just not rational.
Now, I'm not a psychiatrist, Joe. I'm just an old-fashioned GP. But Freud himself would have something to gnaw on here.
Oh.
Well, he happens to seem very rational.
Oh,
extremely
Doc,
rational.
Come
he can
on.
Trace his imaginary life a whole lot clearer than any of us can our own.
So?
His seeming recall is amazing.
But what does that mean?
And one other thing, a little parenthetic aside, let's call it. The fillings in his teeth, there are two of them. No modern-day dentist ever drilled them. And you saw his gun, Joe.
Sure, but it's an antique.
An antique that isn't more than a year old. 100-year-old gun, Joe. And you said yourself it looked like it was manufactured less than a year ago.
I have a little bit of trivia here. This is really fun. Both John Astin and Edward Platt, who were in this episode, would also appear in an episode of The Odd Couple in 1971, 10 years later, called Oscar's New Life. It's a very funny episode. And again, they have no scenes together. They're both cast in the same episode, never have any scenes together. John Astin plays, what does he play? He plays a Hugh Hefner character named Buff Buffington or something. And he has a beard and he's totally doing this Hugh Hefner impersonation. What happens is Edward Platt plays Oscar's boss and he fires him from the newspaper after an argument or something. So Felix is doing a photo shoot for John Astin's men's magazine or something, and he gets an interview with him, and John Astin hires him, and it's a great episode. Okay, so do we have any final thoughts on 100 Yards Over the Rim?
I have enormous respect for it. It's really not one of my favorites, and I don't have any huge issues with it. It just doesn't hit me, and I'm a huge time travel fan.
Right. Time travel is one of the more commonly used themes in Twilight Zone, mm-hmm. if not the most.
Yep, it's good. I mean, it's good. There's nothing wrong with it. I actually, if there's one thing that really recommends it for me, it's just the visuals. It's so beautiful. They're on location. It's so expansive, and really, I have the show on Blu-ray, and when I watched it on Blu-ray on a big TV, I was blown away. I mean, it's so, these giant, extreme faraway shots of him in the middle of this giant desert. I mean, it's just compelling.
Right. Yeah. It's very contrast, high contrast of the dark mm-hmm. and the dirt of him against this Death Valley kind of a
right
thing. Where is it? Is it Death Valley or is it considered to be like New Mexico maybe?
Well, it was shot in
that whole area is.
And this is me not being overly familiar with California. I know it was shot outside of Lone Pine, but I don't know if that's part of Death Valley.
I want to say I really like Cliff Robertson a lot. He has this certain. What really works for me more than anything, what really sells it, is this kind of look of childlike vulnerability in his face.
Mm, sure.
He looks like an innocent little boy in this episode.
He does.
And that's he looks true. Scared to death. And, that really works for me. I like that. So the 100 Yards Over the Rim was written by Rod Serling, directed by Buzz Kulik, and premiered April 7th, 1961. And then we move 2 weeks later. I guess they had a week off. And the Rip Van Winkle caper premiered April 21st, 1961, written by Rod Serling and directed by Justice Addis. This is one of my favorites because, as I said before, it's a story that depends on the stupidity of its central characters, DeCruz and Farwell. Seriously, yes. Those guys should have their own sitcom.
Now, these are masterminds. I mean, these are highly intelligent mastermind criminals.
Apparently, their brains get in the way of a lot of other basic functions.
Something. I mean, though, I don't know. Farwell doesn't seem too bright at any point. But, Farwell or DeCruz doesn't seem too bright.
Well, DeCruz Farwell was removed from his place of residence. That request came from his wife to Farwell. He moved in with Farwell. Sometime earlier, his wife asked him to leave. DeCruz is a scientist. This guy's supposed to be a genius. He figured out a way to cryogenically preserve people, and I forget if there was any explanation for why he wasn't raking in science cash, but right. That would be an incredible discovery.
Sure.
He would have a patent and become a millionaire all on his own anyway. Maybe appeared on the retraction watch list and was discredited by conservatives or something. So Farwell hooks up with a bunch of criminals, like you do. They steal $1 million worth of gold, and the plan is to retreat into a cave, sleep in these modified 80s glass coffee tables for 100 years.
The pièce de résistance now. A real culmination. Ultimate ingenuity. It is one thing, gentlemen, to stop a train on its way from Fort Knox to Los Angeles and steal its cargo. It's another thing to remain free to spend it. And spend it we shall.
Yeah, but when?
Don't you know, Mr. Recluse? I would have thought that this aspect of the plan would be particularly clear in your mind.
Maldito vidrio. Rip Van Winkle. That's what we are. Four Rip Van Winkles.
And then they'll wake up and everybody would have forgotten about the stolen gold. And then they'll walk into a clean slate, wonderful new future with a lot of gold. It's almost a flawless plan, except that knowing what we know, in 2016, this gold probably won't be forgotten. They hide out in the desert, Death Valley, in which case the Manson family would have dug them up, took the gold, and forgotten all about starting a race war. But never mind. They go to sleep. They wake up. The first thing is Farwell made these little coffins out of glass. I'm thinking if it was made from Tupperware, some kind of nice sealed plastic kitchen container, we wouldn't have had a problem with falling rocks. So one of the four guys already dies, asleep and decomposing. That's very nice.
Yeah.
And we go full Treasure of Sierra Madre with Oakland, who is an immoral douche. This is great. They have a truck, but he decides, you know what? We don't need that truck. I'll use it to kill another of our gang. He gets in the truck, runs over another guy, kills him. The truck flips into a canyon, so now it's only DeCruz and Farwell, and I don't think they're carrying all the gold they stole, just enough to fill two backpacks, which is also stupid. I would have kept everything in the cave, taken a bar of gold, found some settlement or town, and arranged for further transport. But Oakland is obviously setting this up to kill Farwell. And let's just ponder this incredibly brilliant plan.
First of all, okay, so it's a big cave. All right, okay. I mean... You could, and we're going to have these very fragile glass caskets.
Right.
Nothing overhead to protect them. I mean, they don't even put like a horse. There's not even a horse blanket spread out on top.
Nothing.
I've never spent a long period of time inside of a cave, but it kind of seems to me like something's going to happen eventually.
Yeah.
I mean.
So why not build something? Something very airtight and fresh or.
Right.
Or even like you said, just put a cover on it. Just put a cover on it. Make me feel better. If I'm part of your gang, I want to know that we're going to be safe.
Right. Why even do it in a cave? Why not do something underground?
Or also, hey, take the gold out, maybe put it someplace. Put the canisters in the truck.
Sure.
We couldn't do that? That's a big truck. It could have fit, four coffin-style containers.
The guy turning into a skeleton struck me as a little false. I mean, even it's cracked, but it's still mostly airtight. He wouldn't be a skeleton even after 100 years. I mean, I think he'd be more mummified.
He'd be like a little bit of rotting flesh there.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I guess they couldn't show that on TV.
No. Standards and practices would be like, if you die, you're a skeleton, okay?
Yeah. And, it's funny because this is also written by Rod Serling, and he wrote the original screenplay for Planet of the Apes. This entire thing is in Planet of the Apes, too.
Yeah, I was thinking about Planet of the Apes a little bit mostly I was thinking about Forbidden Planet because of that car that shows up at the end, but...
Oh, right.
This is, Serling's gift as a writer was irony.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you go through this enormous adventure or this journey or this dramatic situation without thinking something in the back of your head. And Serling is the one who fills the gap at the end. He's the one doing your thinking for you when you're when you're his character, obviously.
Right.
But he takes the gift that we as humanity have for detecting irony out of his characters, a lot of his characters anyway. Mm. I really like Planet. I like the original. I'm really not a fan of the Tim Burton one, but
I hate the Tim Burton one.
As much as I love Tim Burton, his early work. Like the days of, Pee-wee's Big Adventure, Beetlejuice, Batman, that kind of stuff.
Edward Scissorhands.
Edward Scissorhands, good date movie.
Sure.
Hell, I love Batman Returns. I think Michelle Pfeiffer is wonderful anyway.
Oh, sure.
And Ed Wood also, really cool. But after Ed Wood is when his career really started to derail. I watched Mars Attacks and I was like, what the hell is going on here?
I blame Helena Bonham Carter.
They go on this nice little journey and, they're walking down this some parched road or not even a ride. I guess they were on a road or something.
Yeah.
He starts bartering with Farwell, who either drank all his water or didn't pack enough. And he charges a bar of gold per sip.
What's the matter? You pooped already?
You had a good night's sleep. We've only been on the road for a couple of hours.
Stop. Must stop. I must have water. The cruise. Must have water. Well. All right, Farwell.
I got about a quarter of a canteen left.
Please, the cruise. Please, the cruise.
Mr. Farwell. The rate of exchange has gone up a little bit today. It's 2 bars of gold for 1 swallow.
So it's supply and demand. This is capitalism, right?
Absolutely.
So sure. He's like, one sip, one bar of gold. I just want to punch Oakland in the face. But he's a great actor. I love him anyway.
Oh, he is great. And I love that. I love the, you know, that's the price today.
Yeah, I know. It's going to go up. But this tomorrow. is like the Brexit. I mean, the stock market is going to plunge and then it's going to go back up. One sip, one bar of gold. So this episode that I wrote here, right in my notes, man, you were reading my mind, dude. It reminds me of I shot an arrow into the air with the rampant greed and the stupidity, mm-hmm. and also water, apparently.
Yes, yeah, that's why I'm covering those two episodes together on my podcast. There's enough similarity there that
that's great. That's wonderful. Perfect. It's a marriage. It's a perfect marriage.
It is.
So Farwell actually demonstrates that he is smarter than De Cruz because he gives all of his gold to this guy, and obviously he's going to get really, really tired and not be quite on his game, and he's walking ahead of him, so he picks up a bar of gold and just hits him in the head. That's vicious, but it's not over yet. We finally get to, and this is the other characteristic of Rod Serling, in addition to taking the irony out of his characters' heads, he has the sick joke. This is what I always call the sick joke. This is the Rod Serling sick joke. Why don't you reveal that for us?
So Farwell is lying there close to death. Someone approaches, goes back to his vehicle, which is a futuristic car, which
awesome.
up until now, I'm not 100% sure that we have had confirmation that it really is 100 years later.
Not yet.
So there's this car.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Forbidden
Can
Planet
I just interrupt
prop.
You? I'm sorry.
Forbidden
Wouldn't it
Planet
be even
prop.
More sick if it wasn't 100 years in the future that something just went wrong and they only slept for about a week?
That would be wonderful.
That would be that insane.
It could be a sick joke on top of a sick. Well, no, because then the actual sick joke wouldn't work. Because we find out that gold is not rare in this future. At some point between 1961 and 100 years later, they figured out how to make it.
They figured out how to make gold,
which I'm not sure why they would. I mean, what would be the purpose of making it? I mean, suddenly, I mean, the value is gone at that point. I guess they could just use it
if
as
you can make it, then the value is gone. It's kind of like oil, you know, our dependence on oil and somebody builds an electric car or something.
Mm.
And then what happens? I mean, oil becomes worthless, or sort of. I don't know.
Oh, that would be really neat. But
we kind of use oil for a lot of other things than gas and oil and fuel oil these days. We use it for plastic. We use it for other kinds of products, things like that. But, you know, it's nice to dream.
But, yes, all of that for naught.
Also, I wonder what the car runs on. Do you think it runs on water? That would be pretty cool if it did. You know, I'll take a gallon of water.
Yeah, no, that would. So let's see. Oh, so when Farwell murders De Cruz with the gold brick in the desert, and it sounds like we're playing Clue now. Uh-huh. There's a great little sound effect when the gold brick meets like skull. He hits him 3 times.
Wait, do we hear? Does it sound like coconuts? Like bunk.
There's this really nice meaty ka-thunk sound,
ka-thunk.
And it's great. It's like on the third and final blow, it just ka-thunk. And I kept rewinding it the other day as I was watching it. I just got a kick out of that. I wanted to like isolate it, use it as a ringtone or something. And we have the Forbidden Planet car, which is amazing. There's so much Forbidden Planet in the Twilight Zone. It's amazing. And
that car is really kind of big. And as we know, in the future, cars are just getting smaller and smaller. I mean, there is a car parked on my street that I could fit into my tiny little kitchen. I have a kitchen. Well, I mean, the kitchen, it's a nice kitchen. It's a modular kitchen with nice cabinetry and everything,
oh, sure.
But it's designed only to be a kitchen
right.
Because it's got cabinetry, it's got refrigerator, dishwasher, stove, and it's all, everything is like ergonomic, but you can totally fit this tiny little car. I swear this car is no bigger than the kitchen table I'm sitting at right now.
Well, even cars at the time, I mean, in the 60s, there were some really small sports cars.
There were.
So yeah, this is a ginormous thing. And I really, you know, in Forbidden Planet, Robbie the Robot's driving this car, and wouldn't that have been wonderful?
That would have been great, because doesn't Robbie the Robot make an appearance on a Twilight Zone episode later?
He shows up twice.
Season five.
Let's see. It's Uncle Simon and the Brain Center at Whipple's.
Right.
But he also, you can see him in One for the Angels. He's one of the wind-up toys that Lou Bookman
is selling. Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, so for the purposes of a 1961 TV show, that car just immediately says future.
Absolutely.
Future. Yeah.
If you're driving like a Buick that's like, you know, 6 feet tall and then really long or something, and then you look at that, you're like, oh my God. And also, they were like wearing like jumpsuits like you do in the future. Everybody wears jumpsuits too.
Right. Right.
And they probably, I don't know, collect your urine and turn it into water. What they do. It's getting a little Dune-ish there.
They have a Mr. Fusion on the back of that.
So yeah, this episode's a lot of fun if you can just sort of suspend your disbelief at how stupid these people are.
No, it's I don't know if it's, I wouldn't call it a favorite, but I love it. I think it's great. It's one that actually when I first discovered the Twilight Zone, I was a preteen, and I had found these paperback books, just collections of short stories that Rod Serling had adapted from teleplays.
Right.
And this was one of the first ones I ever read, long before I ever saw it. And I just loved it. This was like, I don't know, seventh grade, and I was just in love with this story. And then, so yeah, it always connects back for me to that time when, like, the show was new to me. I there were 156 episodes, and I'd seen like four of them, and I was like, I'm going to be watching this forever.
The first time I ever encountered The Twilight Zone was not the TV show, it was the movie.
Oh.
The movie came out in 83. We had just gotten, we were living in Tennessee. My mother got a job down in Tennessee. We were living down there for a year, and we had just gotten cable, and this movie premiered. In fact, I'm going to make this the basis of an article for my vintage cable box series that I do. Mm-hmm. And my mother said that she watched Twilight Zone all the time when she was a kid. You never watched the Twilight Zone? Where have you been? They don't show this stuff on TV. So I was watching it, and I was like, I really liked it. I liked the movie quite a bit. And I had no idea that there was a TV show that it was originally based on. And then I sought it out, I think, when we moved up to New York. They reran it all the time on Channel 11.
Sure.
In the middle of the night, they would show like four episodes. So, you know, and I'm a night person myself anyway. I was always like that, even when I was younger. So I'd always be up watching old stuff like Star Trek, The Honeymooners, The Odd Couple, and Twilight Zone. And among other things, I think when I was a kid, I was more into, like, I was watching Gilligan's Island, Bewitched, I Dream of Jeannie. Sure.
Well, those shows were on every afternoon when I would come from school.
Yeah.
They would be showing reruns of all of those, so I would see those every day.
Yeah, yeah. And also Rocky and Bullwinkle, I remember watching that. But I watched, and this was one of the first episodes that I watched, and it was one that they constantly repeated, because they didn't really repeat the whole show.
They would
sort of show like these the popular ones, the ones that we really do remember quite a bit, like this one, Midnight Sun.
I love Midnight Sun.
You know, Time Enough at Last, the After Hours, stuff like that. You know, it'd always be stuff that you can always remember. But it didn't show like specific. There were some specific ones when I got the DVD set that I had not seen before, like, let's say, I don't think they showed Death's Head Revisited, and they never showed Big Tall Wish. They never showed any of the fourth season episodes.
Oh,
usually,
right.
You would only find those on the Sci-Fi Channel or something. Mm-hmm. This has been that Twilighty show about that zone. I want to thank my guest for this episode, Craig Beam. Again, you can check out his blogs. Here we go, mylifeintheshadowofthetwilightzone.blogspot.com and mylifeintheglowoftheouterlimits.blogspot.com. www.legitimacy.com, all lowercase, as well as Between Light and Shadow, the podcast that has already premiered as of this time because we've traveled into the future to record this episode, and then we'll be going back. Next time, I will be discussing The Silence and Shadow Play with Colin Hall. Thanks for tuning in, and please, before you steal a whole bunch of gold and put yourself in cryogenic suspension for 100 years, check with Forbes.com, GoldStandardProcon.org, or even Alex Jones to see if it will still be valuable. If I were you, I'd consider investing in penicillin instead. Good night.
Good night.